This is Lisa from Mobile Tech Review, and here is an affordable Android smartphone that, well, doesn't suck, which is pretty good. Now, that's not such a hard thing these days. There's a lot of really nice, affordable Android phones out. This one is the BLU Vivo 8. Now, BLU used to be the phone that you could find at Best Buy, you could find at Amazon, you could find at Fry's. And it was the phone you bought because your paycheck never went far enough to even pay for the basics. You broke your phone and you were desperate for something. Well, this one's actually nice enough that you might choose to buy it, even if you're not financially constrained in a serious way. This one has a full HD Gorilla Glass 3 display, and it's bright and it's colorful. The design on the back, you'll see when we do the up close, is really nice. It's actually reminiscent of the HTC 10, which is, gee, for something that is selling for around $249 right now, pretty darn good. It's unlocked, GSM with 4G LTE. This does not work on Verizon or Sprint, but it does AT&T, T-Mobile, Cricket, MetroPCS, all the GSM carriers. And you've got a good mid-range CPU inside and some more. We're going to look at it now. Well, looks aren't everything, but they sure do help, right? Especially when you're not paying much for a phone, but you'd like to have something that looks like pretty class act. So here's our BLU. This is the last generation HTC phone. So you can see there's some similarities. There's certainly HTC gets the fancier chamfer, but hey, for $250 or so, that's not bad looking. This is also available with gold and a white face. I think that one looks a little less classy. It's hard to make a phone look good in gold, especially for a low price, but it's not too bad. You have a single speaker on the bottom, but, you know, style dictates often that you have balanced drilled holes here. This uses Wave's Max Audio, which is, you know, more often found on PCs than on handsets, but it's a pretty loud and full speaker on it. It really surprised me. Micro USB 2.0, a little bit old-fashioned there, but again, for the price, oh well. We do have a headphone jack, good times. SIM card slot right here. This is a dual SIM card slot phone. So it's the usual arrangement where the first SIM card slot is just your SIM card slot. The second one also can do micro SD cards. So the main SIM card slot is micro SIM, not the more common nano SIM. So you might need an adapter if you're going to use that. And you also want to use your SD card slot for your SD, or, well, it's up to you. Controls over here, the usual power, volume, and the home button is physical, and it is a very fast and very accurate fingerprint scanner. Nice. They call this a curved glass screen. No, not really so much. It is Gorilla Glass 3. It's more like there's a little chamfer. It's got a little raised edge here. It looks kind of nice. You know, you get the idea. It's not just a pretty face, though. You have a MediaTek P10 CPU inside. Now, that's a Helio's P10. I'm not a huge fan of MediaTek CPUs, performance versus power conservation sort of thing, but they have improved a bit. And this one is a 2 gigahertz octa-core CPU. Performs a little bit faster than the mid-range Snapdragon 625, so it's actually not bad. The phone feels fast and fluid on it. You got 4 gigs of RAM and 64 gigs of storage, plus that microSD card slot. By the way, for those of you who use T-Mobile, it does have a band 12. You can visit their website to see all of the LTE bands that are supported here. There's no NFC, not at this price, but you do have dual band Wi-Fi, the usual 802.11ac, and Bluetooth. It's a budget phone, but you get stuff in the box, which is nice. It's not just the charger and the cable and goodbye, thank you very much. So we have a USB host adapter cable in here, which you don't see much these days, a SIM pokey tool. We have, of course, the cable and the charger, and this supports MediaTek's version of fast charging, and it does charge quickly. And we get some earbud headphones even in here with the spaghetti string style on there, and the little can style ends on it. You know, it's nice. Decent for the price to get that stuff. Software. The good part is that this runs Android 7.1.1 Nougat, which, you know, other than Oreo just starting to release Android 8, that's pretty decent stuff. The not as good stuff is that they have software customizations here. They're doing that integration of the app drawer with the home screen. I'm not a big fan of that. That's at least ameliorated if you go to the Google Play Store, which of course is on the phone, and you can download a third-party launcher, even free ones like Nova Launcher, and make things look more normal. The notifications are a little bit customized too. I wish they wouldn't do that, but they do. And messing with the standard Android convention that nobody else messes up with, if you want to get to your quick settings, you're like, wait, where are they, right? You swipe up. I do not know why they did this, unless they're trying to win over iOS people, maybe, who are used to the control center at the bottom. So they're there. They're just at the bottom instead. Yeah. But other than that, it's not too out of the ordinary in terms of what they did. They have features versus settings over here. And this is more like their value-added stuff. Their fingerprint scanner, the Max Audio settings. I don't know why you would want to disable ultra-fast charging. And that's 9-volt, 2-amp charging, by the way. So the rest of it's pretty normal. You have beauty face for your selfie shots, and you've got three different display settings for temperature. You've got normal, cool, and warm. It's up to you as to how you like it. So there's the software. And the apps bundled on here, I did not put these on. It came with Opera. It came with Next Radio. You can see a couple of other utilities. I have a flashlight utility. Final Fantasy seems inescapable these days on phones. It's always bundled. And stuff you can delete most of that stuff if you don't want it happily. You'll also notice a little Amazon folder over here, and that's because they get in tight with Amazon and they often have Amazon branded phones. There was a little brouhaha about Amazon worried that there might be some Chinese back-end software on older models of BLU. It didn't affect newer models like this one here, so this is sold on Amazon. They have no issues with this phone. The rear camera is 13 megapixel, and they use a Sony IMX 258 sensor and an f2.0 lens. For the price, that's not too bad. Obviously, the bottom here is iOS inspired, the way you move between things. You got your beauty face, you got your video, you have panorama, you have night mode, you have slow motion, you got time lapse, several filter effects, and you can get to your other settings here. We have HDR, and it takes a pretty decent picture. And we'll take a look at that one that we just shot, and that looks just fine. Now this is an interesting one because this was taken in a real low light environment and the colors are nice and the amount of detail here is pretty good. So at this price, I have no complaints whatsoever with the camera. Front camera is pretty sharp and pretty decent, and that beauty effect is handy if you have zits, if you got Dorito crumbs on your chin, you know who you are. Again, despite the maybe less than tasteful skin, or not to my preference anyway, the performance on this is fine. It feels fluid. It is on 2.2, your detail version of the score. Base version right there. Geekbench 4, iStorm Unlimited, and lastly Slingshot, which is a pretty tough test. So again, mid-range, upper mid-range performance, again, similar to the Snapdragon 625. So it's not a terrible phone. It's not a slow phone by any means. It's actually reasonably good in terms of performance. It has a 4,010 milliamp power battery. That's a pretty decent size capacity battery, one of the larger ones. Combine that with just having a 1080p display, which is 401 ppi, by the way, so that's not such a bad thing. And the mid-range CPU, then you've got some pretty good stamina from the battery here. This is certainly an all-day phone, unless you're going to be playing Pokemon Go all day long or something crazy like that. It lasts. And again, it supports fast charging. You've got a 9-volt, 2-amp charger in the box. Not bad. Not bad at all. So that's the BLU Vivo 8. It is definitely their nicest phone yet, and they weren't kidding when they said that this time around. Nice metal construction on here, really big battery. Combine that with that 1080p display and a mid-range CPU. Even though MediaTek's not as power frugal generally as the Qualcomm Snapdragon, and you still got an Energizer Bunny of a phone that's going to last. It has loud speakers. It has a nice bright display. The cameras are pretty good on it too, and that 16-megapixel selfie camera. Well, if you're the selfie type, you're going to like that. Granted, there are some competitors. The biggest one would be the Moto E5 Plus, and Moto does affordable phones nice. I would say, arguably, this is the more physically attractive looking phone. Just to look at it, it looks like a classier piece of tech. You get a little bit bigger display, you get higher resolution cameras, a little bit better performance when it comes to the CPU inside, and a bit more RAM too. Moto fights back by supporting Verizon and Sprint, CDMA as well, and they have a cleaner software build I think more people are going to like, so it's always good to see competition. I'm Lisa from Mobile Tech Review. Be sure to subscribe to our YouTube channel for more cool tech videos, and thumbs up if you like this vid.